The next speaker is Swami Brahmavidananda. Brahmavidananda is, Swamiji is the founder of Arshya Vidya Foundation, which is the organizer of the Vedic Wisdom Festival. He is a traditional and a contemporary teacher of Vedanta. Hopefully in the next 45 minutes you will see both the traditional and the contemporary happening here. His own guru, Pujya Swami Dayanand Saraswati Ji, has acknowledged him as a significant Mahatma. Apart from teaching for 30 years in Mumbai, he is also a corporate trainer and is an exponent of karate, judo and tai chi. And he was a marine engineer before he became a Swamiji. He connects with youth and geriatrics and everybody in between. That's what I found about him. Having said all good things, being very close to him, one weakness of his which I am aware of, which I have not taken his permission to announce on the stage, but I'll risk it, is that he's extremely fond of cheese and chocolates. That's how I've been in his good books for so many years. Before we start his subject, there is a traditional way of welcoming sannyasis. It's called the Purna Kumbha. It also indicates how auspicious it is to have a sannyasi in our midst. And you will see that every single Swamiji or sannyasi who comes and speaks on stage over the next 2 days will be welcomed in the traditional manner by offering a Purna Kumbha. May I request Panjabigation and Mangala to please do the needful.
परेण नाकन्निहितं गुहायां विभ्राजते यद्यतयो विशन्ति वेदांत विज्ञान सुनिश्चितार्थास सन्यास योगाद्यतय शुद्ध सत्वा आहा ते ब्रह्म लोकेषु परा अंतकाले परामृतात् परिमुच्यन्ति सर्वे दहरं विपापं परमे एष्म भूतै यत्पुण्डरीकं पुरमध्यसद्गुस्थं तत्रापि दहरं गगनं विशोकस्तस्मिन् यदन्तस्तदुपासितव्यं यो वेदादौ स्वरः प्रोक्तो वेदार्थे च प्रतिष्ठितः तस्य प्रकृतिलीनस्य यः परः स महेश्वरः ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः
आचार्य मध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्य पर्यन्ताम् वन्दे गुरु परम्पराम् Nobody lives in the world that is there. We all live in the world that we think is there. Our perceptions define our reality. Somebody looking backstage may think, there's a nice backdrop, you know, because against black, all of us stand out very nicely, especially those of us with grey hair. Somebody else may think, black yaar, come on. Apashakun hai ye. So, what your emotional state will be depends upon what you interpret, what you see. And we all know the world is not what it seems to be. That's why so much of science, research, etc. is on. And we question the reality about ourselves also. What exactly am I? What do I really want out of life? As our chief guest said, it seems to be an exchange. First 40 years, earn the money, sacrifice the health. Next 40 years, spend the money to maintain there. So what are we really doing? Every human being wants certain satisfaction and fulfillment in life. This is unquestionable. You ask anyone. In fact, you ask a child, what do you want to be? Most likely the child will say, I want to be happy. But then we teach the child, yeah, that is true, but to be happy, what do you want to be? Just be happy. Just be fulfilled. But then as a process of socialization, as a process of our education, we have picked up various notions of what happiness is. If I get that money, I'll be happy. If I get that house, I'll be happy. If I get married, I don't want to say anything more. Okay. Are we? So the question is, what is it that will make us fulfilled beings? So Vedanta says, get real in life. Get real. What do you mean real? That can be another question. What is real? How do you get real? We can use this in the psychological sense, get real. Because the word real is used differently. Here, let us examine these words that we have in our day-to-day language. In our common parlance, table is real, body real, flowers real, they're not fake, okay. They're real. The horn on my head, real? Real or not real? What is it?
Not real.
Not there at all. Tuchcha means Sanskrit. Not there at all. Even though some people have accused me of behaving as though I have one. Plead guilty. So, my horn, not real. My head, real, all right. Table, real. Then we have another word, real, not real, false. What is false? The mirage water is false. The snake that you see on the rope is false. So why is this? Now look at it. The rope is also your perception. The snake on the rope is also your perception. Why are you taking one perception as true and the other perception as false? Swami, that's very simple. The rope is subject to negation, right? The snake is subject to negation. Hey, please be alert when you listen to me, okay? This snake is subject to negation, but the rope remains a rope. Even if I go close and examine the snake disappears. The few people dare to do that. You see a snake, nobody will want to go close to examine it. Okay, put your torch on. See, correct. Though there are some who will say, where did the snake go? Because they're so obsessed with that snake. Where did the snake go? There is no snake. This is false. So, because it is negatable, we say it is false. Therefore, using what you have said, let me define, or rather the Shastra defines, what is true, what is real, as that which cannot be negated. Abhaditam satyam. Now we have a problem. If you define like that, the unreal will remain unreal, no problems. My horns will remain the same, unreal, not real, non-existent. The false, rope, snake, etc., the mirage, water, etc., will remain false. That also not a problem. But you have a problem with everything else. What you took as real before. The table is real. Really? There's nothing but wood. Where is the table? I come from a culture where there is no tables. I can recognize the wood. Is there a table apart from the wood? Is there a table apart from the wood?
No.
So the table is negated in your understanding of the wood. Can you say the table is false?
No.
Can you say this table is false? Like the rope snake? No. Table is useful. I can put a glass of water on top of it. But is it non-negatable? It's not that thick. One chop, there's no more table left. The only piece is left. Don't worry, whosoever the table is, I'm not going to do it. Where is table? Am I wearing a real kurta or a false kurta? Is this kurta a perception like rope snake? Like mirage waters? Or the emperor's clothes? Non-existent? No, no. Is it real? Yeah, it's a kurta. Nothing but cloth. Where is kurta? This is cloth, this is cloth, this is cloth. Why are you giving all these different names? It's all cloth. In the ashram, we have the tradition of dressing up like our Ganapati here. You only wear cloth. One cloth below, one cloth on top. Correct? Simple dressing, easiest dressing. But it's cloth. Where did the kurta go? Kurta is right here. But it's nothing but cloth. Can you all think? Don't make and give it to me, okay? I will not put that load on you. Can you think of a kurta without cloth or any material? So whatever you have taken as real is subject to negation. Not real. What we take as existential truth, whether the existential philosophy or science, what is taken as real is what you can, what is available for your five senses. And all that is available for your five senses is subject to negation, as I just shown. This body, body nothing but hydrocarbon, Baba. Nothing but an arrangement of cells and molecules and connective tissue and all that stuff, that's all. Where is this? Negative. But functional, all right. Don't think it is false. If you walk into my punch, you'll know how real it is. But it's still not real, negatable. The hand is negatable. What I can do with this hand is negatable. The energy that keeps me alive, negatable. It has to be created and sustained and all that. By the food that you eat, the air that you breathe, by the information you get, all that sustains the energy. Your emotions sustain it. Your mantras sustain it. So you build up the energy through the mantras, and you use the energy for the mantra to build it up further. It goes both ways. Doesn't have independent existence. Not real. Mind, you all know what your emotions are. Morning will be I love you, by evening it is I love you. You go your way, I go my way. Emotions. Angry at night, next morning you're okay. Advice to all couples. Don't go to bed angry with each other. Stay up and fight. Okay. Well, you get it, finish that anger, na? Better that way. So, emotions. What's real? Knowledge. Knowledge is being disproved every day. Every day, later discoveries are disproving earlier ones. Even Einstein is being questioned. All that is negatable. All that I have taken myself to be, you know, look at it. I started with the world, I come to myself. My body, my mind, my emotions, my knowledge, my memories. Memory was my interpretation of what happened. The interpretation itself is open to question. Then I remember what interpreted. Negatable. You forget so many things. Negative. Now, what is real? What is real? The Shastra comes here and says, you are the real. Which you? The one that is aware of the body, aware of the mind, aware of your emotions, aware of your thinking, your knowledge, your ignorance, all that, the one that is aware of all that, that's the only reality. Try to negate that. Body I have already negated conceptually. Mind, etc., easy to negate. All of you have negated your mind and knowledge when you go to sleep. You don't need any samadhi experience. Your sleep is good enough to negate it. You are the only thing that is not negatable. You can negate the whole world. And Swamiji, I can negate you, you can negate me. Are we both not negatable then? You can negate my body, which I also negate. You can negate my emotions, which I can also negate. You can negate my knowledge, which I can also negate. You can negate my ignorance, which I can also negate. But the I that is aware of all this, non-negatable. Homework for you, okay? Any teachers in the audience? Yeah, yeah, there are a couple of teachers. Very good. Always wanted to give teachers homework, you know. For the empire strikes back. For all the homework they gave me when I was, yes.
We gave homework to ourselves.
Yeah. When you go back home, sit down and try to negate yourself. Okay. In your understanding, sit down and keep trying to negate. you'll find that you are the only non-negatable entity. That means what? Abhaditam Satyam, that Satyam that we are talking about, is I. Alright, I am Satyam. Unreal, my horns remain unreal. False, mirage water, rope snake, etc. remain false. Now what do we call what is in between? All that you are negated. This table. This body. What do you call that? In Sanskrit we have a word. In English we don't have a word. Because this idea is not there in English. It was not expressed in English. It was expressed in Sanskrit. So in Sanskrit, we have a word, it is called Mithya. And what do you call it in English? Mithya. The closest you can come to an English word is something which is apparent, not real. But maybe functionally valid. Table is functionally valid. This body is definitely functionally valid. It may become invalid sometime in the future, but not today, not now. What is functionally valid is also Mithya. We have this thinking, those of you who have read Vedanta and not been exposed to a traditional teacher, that Mithya is something which is false. No. Mithya, all that is functionally valid is Mithya. Look at my definition. All that is functionally valid is Mithya. Because for function, you need a form. A form has to be dependent on an object. Therefore, the form is negatable. This table is a form which is dependent on wood. This kurta is a form dependent on cloth. This body is a form dependent on hydrocarbons. So a dependent reality is Mithya. All functioning entities, all functionally valid entities are Mithya. So what is real in your life? You, nothing else. What is real? You are the only reality. And the whole attempt in Vedanta is to understand this reality. Why? My very pursuit for happiness starts with a fundamental assumption that I am not happy. No? With a fundamental assumption that I am a finite entity bound by time and space. I have a birth, I have a death. Nobody doubts that. Huh? I have a horoscope, which sometimes looks like a horoscope. My life, okay? Sometimes looks like a horoscope. Based on that assumption, we go about seeking this, seeking that. In the vision of the Shastra, I am not going to unfold too much of that vision. In the vision of the Shastra, this entity that I talked about as the real I is free from all limits, free from the hold of time and space. Unlimited, limitlessness, nothing but ananda. It Therefore, without changing anything in your life, you can discover you are nothing but Ananda. If I'm Ananda, why don't I know it? If I am the only reality, why don't I know it? After all, I am there, my mind is there, I should know. Yeah, but that mind is shrouded by ignorance. We are all born ignorant. In fact, ignorance is the capital with which we are born. Isn't it true? As a baby, what did I know? Nothing, not even my mama. She was a source of nourishment, that's all I knew. Mama was a heartbeat. Mama was food. Did I know anything more than that? Born ignorant of myself and the world. Joy. Look at how ignorant we are born with. And as we live, we shed this ignorance. Shed this ignorance. Ignorance about my body, mind, etc. Ignorance about the world. Until so much we can go to the moon and come back. We meaning the human race. India still have to do it. Maybe next year or the year after that. Go to the moon and come back. We can do that. Go to Mars. Dreaming of Mars. And all the time, self-ignorance is sitting quietly in my heart. The only grace is everyone is self-ignorant. So we are all on common grounds. That's a given, like, you know, for everyone. So then when you see someone like us, who says we know ourselves, you think these characters are mad. They're talking about something else. Anyway, they're oddly dressed. Who dresses like this in today's world? So the whole attempt in Vedanta is to know yourself. In fact, what you will see over the next 2 days will be two things. One, people dealing directly with I. Two, dealing with the mind and the world so that you can have a mind. The world is managed well, your mind and body is managed well so that your attention is available to gain this knowledge about yourself. The whole thing will be based on this. So now for the sake of functioning, let us give it a few terms. This absolute reality that we talked about, I, is called paramarthikam in Sanskrit, absolute reality. That which cannot be negated, paramarthikam. The functioning world, which is real, functionally real, we call it as vyavaharikam, your transactional world, your empirical world. What you make out of it is called pratibhasikam, your subjective world. Oh, this flower is so beautiful, I love it. I love it. It's pratibhasikam, because somebody else may not like it. Swami, how can anyone not like this beautiful flower? I know this guy. He went to propose to his girlfriend with a bouquet in hand and a ring in his pocket. And she threw out the flowers and stomped on his heart. Now he can't stand the sight of flowers. He doesn't go anywhere near a florist. I hate it. He reminds me of the pain. Pratibhasikam. I love it. Pratibhasikam. He hates it. Pratibhasikam. Now what is it? Flower. Though the pratibhasikam will be a part of your living. Of course, it'll be a part of your living. Your emotions are a part of your living. But your emotions are not real. You can't judge only on the basis of emotion, can you? No, Swamiji. All we need to make our marriage successful is love. Yeah. When you're young, you think you can live on love and fresh air. That love will die in the pots and pans of the kitchen. Why? There's a life to be lived, Baba. You need much more than love. Good communication to start with. Of course I love, but it's gifted in your heart. The other person doesn't then know it. But I love her, if she loves me, she should know it. Well, love makes your mind read her out. So emotions are not. Emotions are there. It colors your life. It gives a color to your life. How was it being like the black screen beginning? It gives a color. That's good. But it is pratibhasikam. It is not real. It may not be functionally valid also. Like our chief guest will say, with regards to our share market, fear and greed drives the market, isn't it? Fear and greed drives the market. So I told some stockbrokers, you know, do you really want to know how to handle that fear and greed? They were not too sure. Because that's what driving the market. If they learn to handle it, they'll know how to handle the market. But they don't. They rather be afraid and handle the market rather than handle the market fearlessly. So emotions, your pratibhasikam plays a role. But remember, the pratibhasikam is based on your what? Your subjective world is based on your functional world, your vyavaharika world. If the flower is not there, the question of me loving or not liking or hating doesn't come up into the picture only. Now we say, therefore the vyavaharika, the functional, the kurta, has to be based on the real actually. How can it be based on the real? It's based on cloth. Now, I think the people are getting it. So I'll go a little deeper. Can I go a little deeper? Okay, all right. If I can go a little deeper. Look at it. This kurta is based on cloth. Correct? It's not paper, you can examine it. Okay. I wouldn't take that risk with the Bombay traffic or the Bombay crowds in the buses and trains. Not based on paper, it's based on cloth, solid cloth. That doesn't tear easily also. Okay. And the cloth is based on what? Yarn. And the threads, which is based on fibers. Correct. Which is based on fibers is a structure of what? Of some molecules. Let's skip a few steps. Molecules are an arrangement of atoms, arrangement of particles. Where does it stop? Where will it stop? Because if you give me a word, that word will be dealing with a substance. The substance will be nothing but an arrangement. They come to atoms and particles. Because that's how science, far science has come, and I'm using the example from science. So up to particles. You know, just 70 years ago, 80 years ago, we thought atom was indivisible. Then Hiroshima and Nagasaki, we split the atom. That time we are talking of three fundamental particles. Now there are 132. And we are wondering whether the final particle is a particle or a string. String theory, the latest that we need to replace is a string. Or is there a particle or an energy? Is the electron a particle or an energy? Then finally the scientist said, when you observe it, it's a particle. When you are not observing it, it's an energy wave. So I turned around and asked the scientist, why? Is the electron self-conscious that when I observe it freezes up into a particle? And when it is, it looks like that, you observe it's a particle. No, I'm joking, okay, don't take me seriously and say Swamiji said this, that the electron is self-conscious, please. Whatever, the final particle will have to have no form. Because if it has a form, I will resolve it into its content. Kurta form, content cloth. Cloth form, content yarn. Threads. Threads form, content fibers. I'll keep resolving it. So the final particle has to be what? Don't say nothing. This kurta, the sangha vasaram, all are very real things. It's not nothing, it's an existing thing. You can hang somebody with this. Correct? Yeah, people use this, no? When things go into well in life, hang yourself up. It's not nothing. If this is not nothing, the final particle cannot be nothingness. It has to be nothing but formless existence. Because it exists. We are dealing with existing. The kurta is existing. Remember, we started with the kurta. The kurta is existing. So the final particle has to be existence without a form. Wow. Now when I use the word formless, people think they understand. And they have some vague nebulous shape like the amoeba. Amoeba is not formless, it is shapeless. Formless means no boundaries, no limits. No boundaries, no limits. That means what? Unconditioned by time and space, because that's the limit everything has. Sadeva Saumedhavum Agram Asit Ekameva Adutiyam Brahman. The Upanishad says that all that is there before this was one existence. Formless existence. Which is what? Abhaditam Satyam. Remember, don't forget that. You are the Satyam. And that is the formless existence. Samji, how can I be formless existence? I said you are the Satyam because you are the one that is aware of all that. You cannot be negated. Correct? That means you are a conscious entity. Now, this is another big thing in the world of science today, the question of consciousness. I read some papers on this. But all the consciousness that science is talking about is that which is manifest in your brain, in your mind. We are talking about the consciousness that objectifies the brain and the mind. Your brain is an object of your consciousness. Your mind, your emotion, thinking, memory, etc. is an object of your consciousness. That I consciousness. Can this I consciousness be limited by time? Ready to go further?
Yes.
Or too much already? I want a response from the audience. Ready to go further?
Yes.
Good. Then we'll go further. Can this I consciousness be limited by time?
No.
Let us examine it. Let us examine in brief. What is this thing that we call time? What is time? Now this time reminds me of what happened to me when I was walking on the road with an American friend. And this man walked up and said, "Sir, what is time?" So I understood what he was saying. This is charvaj gaya. And he went to me. And my American friend turns around and says, "You Indians are very philosophical." He walked up to you and asked a philosophical question, "What is time?" The thing, I mean, I didn't want to enlighten him too much. If he has a nice opinion of India, let him have. That's our Indian English, that's all. Anyway, what is this thing that we call time? To make matters simple, let us go by the basic scientific definition of time. Because this is what you all are aware of. As instead of going too much into the Shastra, I'll take what is known. Time is what? Gap between two events. Basic definition. The gap between two events is time. olden days, time was gap between sunrise and sunset. Then as we needed more sophisticated ideas, measurements of time, we started making the events more sophisticated. Until finally, you all wear your God's watches, it became the gap between two pulses of a God's. But this basic definition remained the same. Gap between two events. Again going by science, is there an event without an observer? Is there an event without an observer of the event? According to science, not possible. If there is an event, there has to be an observer. So, two observations, the gap between two observations is time. That means one thought, second thought, the gap between that is time. And who's there between the thought? What is connecting up to the true thought? Me, the conscious being. That means when you are looking at me, this abhaditam satyam, this non-negatable I, this non-negatable reality, through these thoughts, you get this illusion called time. So can that time limit be consciousness? It can limit this body, all right, of course it will. Ab to bilkul buda hu, goli kha kar jeeta hu. Yes, you can say that. Body is limited by time. Mind is limited, of course it is. Knowledge is limited by time. But I, the consciousness, unlimited by time. Unlimited by space. So what are you seeking? All that you are seeking is already within you. This infinite being, when it manifests in a non-projecting mind, you feel happy. Isn't it true? To mimic that song, Main Rasta Par Ja Raha Tha, Bombay Rasta Par Ja Raha Tha, Bilpuri Ne Khata, Rasta Par Ja Raha Tha. And suddenly, between the two buildings, I saw the full moon. Ah, Kartika Deep. Full moon just went a few days back, 9 days back. Ah, beautiful. What happened? The ananda that I am, the fullness that I am, when it manifests in my mind, I feel joyful. Stuck in the Bombay traffic, cursing the government. They want to make it Bombay the financial capital of India, etc. What is this traffic? Anything blame the government, anyway. Forgetting that I am adding one more because of my car. One person. Anyway. Neighboring car, there's a baby gurgling away, looking out of the window. Look at her. Ah. Kermit gone, jam gone, everything gone. Total, that baby. My fullness, my limitlessness, manifested in that mind. Arrested by that baby. All my thoughts were arrested by that baby, the fullness that I am manifested. Sitting at home, reading something serious, kept it as a, okay, let me think about it. And suddenly I had an ESP, someone calling me. So I walked into the fridge, into the kitchen, opened the fridge, and picked up what was calling me, that piece of dark chocolate, and put it in my mouth. Ah, the fullness that I am manifest, because everything else resolved in that chocolate. Chocolate, no, in me. Chocolate was only a nimitta. Baby was only a nimitta, an instrument. The moon was only an instrument. Ah. what you are is this fullness itself. Pending discovery, all that you have to do is discover this. That's all that Vedanta teaches you. That's what is called moksha. Moksha is not after death. Then who will want moksha? You want to die? Everyone wants to live a day more. Even those who say, I want to die, they want to die because of some reason. They don't see themselves being freed from that reason. If I can give them a freedom from that, of course I won't. I'm illness, too many illness. If I can cure you, then I would like to live. I'm unhappy, if I can make you happy, then I won't do that. So, pending discovery, it is you. So that's all that Vedanta promises, that's all that Vedanta teaches. Yourself as an absolute reality. Everything else is in Vedanta is to make you understand that. It talks about creation, it talks about meditation, it'll talk about karma yoga, it'll talk about bhakti, and a lot of things. You'll hear over the 2 days. It'll talk about astrology, about the Vedic havans, everything. All that. Sarvato akhilam partha jnane pari samapyati. It all ends up in the self-knowledge. The whole thing, the karma, this, that, all that. Our Ganapati is a very scholarly person. He put up a whole list of what all necessary for studying the Veda. People may have got scared. All this I have to study. No, only one thing. You have to know yourself. So what else you have to do for that? You have to do for that. Because that knowledge has to take place in a mind. A mind that is ready to know. And that readiness to know is not how much Sanskrit you know. Or how much English you know. That depends upon your emotional maturity. A little bit more maturity than we talk about in the world. In one shot, adhikaritva will be called only maturity. You want me to put in a nutshell? I'll put in a nutshell. Think clearly, feel strongly, act decisively. It takes a lot to be that. Is that so? Think clearly, feel deeply, act decisively. That's all it takes. So therefore you will have meditation, you will have karma yoga, you will have a lot of things coming in to help you get there. And the knowledge will take place with the teaching. Any knowledge requires a pramana. To know what is there on the table, I need my eyes. And if my eyes are limited, I will need some help in terms of my spectacle. Ah, now that is clear. You need that. Similarly, the pramana for knowing yourself. The pramana for knowing yourself. Pramana meaning means of knowledge. Pramakaranam. That which can give you that knowledge is called Vedanta. For your Vedic wisdom. Vedic wisdom is a broader term. The Upanishad that is called Vedanta is called the Veda Shikara, the crowning glory of the Vedas. And that is the means for knowing this. And you need an insight into it, a peep into it. This is what we teach in our classes and everything. All of us here, who are traditional teachers, teach this. And that is what the subject matter is. The subject matter for Vedanta is you. You're not teaching it. You are not learning a text, you are learning you. And everything else is to get that mind to understand this. So you will find over these 2 days, all that will be dealt. Either you will be dealing with the truth directly or in terms of getting your mind ready. Everything will be that. So I have spoken for 45 minutes as Suresh asked me to. So, are there any questions? Shoot. Yes, sir.
So, there are.
Will someone just pass the mic?
Yeah, there are
There are two real volunteers with two real godless minds. who will reach you. And you can please, if you don't mind, telling us your name and then asking the question.
Swamiji, my name is Krishna.
Yes.
You referred to Mithya. Is it the same as Maya or is it different?
The product of Maya is called Mithya. The world is supposed to be a product of Maya. So we'll call that as Mithya.
Okay. Thank you.
It's behind you. Yeah, you sir. The lady in the green. No? Okay. Oh, sorry. You're the one. What?
Okay. Anybody else? Any questions?
Yeah. Yeah.
Swamiji, namaste. I'm Mahesh.
Yeah.
When you say you or I, is it reference to Atma or soul or something?
That's a good question. I don't use the word soul generally because I have not one but I have four souls. I'm not joking, I have four souls. Two palms, two feet. Okay, the souls. Jokes apart. The word Atman also means I. In Sanskrit, Atman is another word for I. The question is, what is your standpoint? When I am saying you are abhadita, not negatable, you are the reality, I am talking about the I which is aware of everything. When I say I am tall or short, I am referring to the body. Why? Because the mistaken notion that I am only this much. I am the body is a concept. Because if you are the body, if an arm is chopped off, God forbid, if an arm is chopped off, would I still be me or would I be less? I'm still the same person, I don't have one hand, that's all, isn't it? The idea of I is still there. I won't say I am I minus. In fact, if somebody feels like that, we'll give the person some therapy, etc., to make the person feel, oh, I am complete in spite of one hand not being there. That's why the term uses differently abled. Why? Because I am more than the body. Body is only one small aspect, an idea. So when I'm talking about the I in Vedanta, we talk about what generally is mistaken as a soul, mistakenly referred to. A better word would be Atma, yes. I, the consciousness, which is aware of everything. Take it like that now. I, the consciousness, which is aware of everything. Am I making sense to you? Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Mr. Jayashree.
Yeah.
I observe these days, youngsters are confused. And so many unwanted things are happening. Can you suggest something that I will go into the society and do something good for the young generation?
Get them to the Vedic Wisdom Festival.
Sir,
I'm happy to see so many youngsters here.
They are there,
yeah.
But not many are outside.
That is true.
In my house also.
Correct.
So I want certain tips from where I can start.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Get 10 youngsters together, we will take a workshop for them. Swamini is here and I am making this commitment on behalf of both of us. Get 10 youngsters together, I will come and take a workshop, she will come and take a workshop.
Done.
Yeah, done. As a practical thing. Number two, we are quick to point out youngsters are confused. Are we clear? You know, youngsters are experimenting with life. We all did that. In fact, when I interact with youngsters, one thing I tell them is, you know, what you all fantasize about doing, I have already done all of that. I have come out fine. I'm sure all of you will come out fine. Come on, if a sailor can become a Vedanta teacher, there is hope for everyone. A ready sailor can be a Vedanta Acharya. Isn't there hope for everyone? Yeah, so it's like cells are confused, it's natural to be confused. When you are growing up, confusion is necessary. If you are not confused, there is something wrong with you. You are not thinking enough. It's part of the game. So let them be confused. Yeah, we can offer some guidance on this if they want it. That's why I said, get some people together, I'll come. I wouldn't believe in trusting it down to someone who doesn't want it. Yeah. And I will also assure you, youngsters relate to me quite well. In fact, they come and tell me things they won't tell their parents. Why? Because they know this guy has done something worse and he'll accept us as we are, so no problems. That's the game. Every generation felt that about the next generation. I'm sure these youngsters, when they grow up, they'll feel the same about the youngsters in their lives. It's part of the game. Okay? Yeah.
We have time for one last question. Yeah.
My name is M.L. Kantarao.
Yeah.
Swamiji, when we attend such programs,
yeah,
and talks by various spiritual teachers, we get a lot of motivation.
Yep.
And some kind of thought that we should also improve in our life in all aspects.
Yeah.
But when we go back home and continue our normal activities, we tend to get reduced by this knowledge which we are getting here.
Yeah.
That slowly gets depleted.
Yes.
So how do we sustain this interest for a long time?
Okay.
Good, very, very valid question, because this is the question all of us faced when we were studying as well. And on behalf of Swamiji and me, I am making a commitment here. Okay. All of you, those who have given me your email address, your WhatsApp number, etc., we have asked for that. Every month, you will get something, a couple of things following up. Every month you will get at least two follow-up things. Maybe a video, maybe an audio, maybe a post, maybe whatever. You will get something to follow it up, number one. Number two, we have classes all over. And we are planning new classes as well, where new people can join. And if I have your numbers, emails, etc., we will see that the message reaches you, so that you can follow up even more seriously. More in a more committed manner. We assure you that.
Ask how much commitment we have. While I agree that when we go out inspired from here, but after that, somehow other priorities tend to take over. If you are able to prioritize, it's been my experience, if you are able to prioritize this and actually give it time. So a camp is being organized. Can you take out those 3 days and go for the camp? Or is your daughter coming from abroad and you'd rather be home because she's visiting you? It's a choice you have to make, right? So it's a tough one. It's a tough one, but I think those are the commitment level required from students like us also, while opportunities are being provided by Swamini and Swamiji. Thank you very much, Swamiji, for a wonderful 45 minutes and a good Q&A.